In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Thank you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Collect for the third Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin and have sent the Spirit of your Son into our hearts, whereby we call you Father. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that we and all creation may be brought to the glorious liberty of the children of God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the prophecy of Jeremiah. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied, and bring back to this place, from Babylon, the vessels of the house of the Lord, and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing, and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. This is the word of the Lord.
A reading from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies, to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations, for just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed? The end of these things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Jesus said to the 12, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly, I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." This is the Gospel of the Lord. May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I wonder what are the most precious things that you have inherited. Here are some of mine. This is my grandfather's walking stick in the shape of a dog. It has no intrinsic value at all, but it's been worn by his hands. It was made of resin. This is just resin, and you can see the colours, the green and the red, as his hand wore it down to the resin from which it's made, but it's very precious to me. This is my father's Bible. It was given to him when he was 9 years old in 1944, and he kept it and used it all the way through when he joined up in boys' service, when he was in the army, and then beyond that. It's my dad's Bible. It was precious to him all his life. And then these are my mother's recipes. It's an old Delia Smith book, and she's collected all these recipes in here, some of which she's written, but some of which she's just collected. But here, in this little book, she wrote out the recipes that she'd had from her grandmother, when her grandmother taught her how to cook all those years ago. And so that's very, very precious to me. But I've also inherited left-handedness, an ability to be able to dream and imagine things into being that aren't yet. I've inherited the ability to analyse data and information really accurately and well, and also an ability to really see people and understand them. All of these are arguably much more precious, actually, and much more use, to be truthful, than these physical things that I've shown you now. And of course, I've inherited the gospel of Jesus. It's been inherited from some people that were very, very important to me in my late teens, who handed on the gospel to me, and I welcomed the gospel. I was hospitable to them and to it, and ultimately to the Lord Jesus Christ, who I welcomed into my heart, mind, and life. Now, the gospel reading talks about this. Jesus predicts that this is what's going to happen, that the faith down the ages is like this great big long relay race. It all begins in the mission-hearted mind of the Father. The Father who gives of himself in creation and who gives of himself in salvation and imparts himself to the world in the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus says, if you welcome me, then you welcome the one who sent me. But he also says to the apostles, these apostles that he's just chosen, who are going to take his message out, that anyone who welcomes you welcomes me and welcomes the one who sent me. And of course, the apostles then imparted the message of Christ to others after Christ had died. And people received the message from the apostles, and then the apostles died. And then those people, having received the message of the apostles, imparted that message to other people who believed and received it. And then they died, and so on down the generations. I wonder who it was who really caught your imagination, who imparted to you not just the content of the gospel, but the importance of it, who has inspired in you this sense of spirituality, of needing to be open to God, of worship, of the Christian faith. Because it's not normal anymore to believe. The percentages of those who are Christians in our land are, you know, something between around about 5%, I suppose. So we aren't common anymore. Something happened. It's important to you. Who was it who did that for you? We have received the gift of the gospel and received it in a particular way, in a particular form, and we have received it in our own unique way also. This sequence of receiving a precious gift, holding it, it being important to us, it's shaping our lives, and then us handing it on, reminds me of a wonderful children's story called Badger's Parting Gifts. It's a story that I've used to help children to understand death and bereavement. I hope you won't mind if I share it now.
Badger's Parting Gifts by Susan Varley. Read by Ruby Dee. Badger was dependable, reliable, and always ready to help when help was needed. He was also very old, and he knew almost everything. Badger was so old that he knew he must soon die. Badger wasn't afraid of death. Dying meant only that he would leave his body behind, and as his body didn't work as well as it had in days gone by, Badger wasn't too concerned about that. His only worry was how his friends would feel when he was gone. Hoping to prepare them, Badger had told them that someday soon he would be going down the long tunnel, and he hoped they wouldn't be too sad when it happened. One day, as Badger was watching Mole and Frog race down the hillside, he felt especially old and tired. He wished more than anything that he could run with them, but he knew his old legs wouldn't let him. He watched Mole and Frog for a long time, enjoying the sight of his friends having a good time. It was late when he arrived home. He wished the moon good night and closed the curtains on the cold world outside. He made his way slowly down to the warm fire that was waiting for him deep underground. He had his supper and then sat down at his desk to write a letter. When he had finished, he gently rocked himself to and fro and soon was fast asleep, having a strange yet wonderful dream like none he'd ever had before. Much to Badger's surprise, he was running. Ahead of him was a very long tunnel. His legs felt strong and sure as he ran towards it. He no longer needed his walking stick, so he left it lying on the floor of the tunnel. Badger moved swiftly, running faster and faster through the long passageway until his paws no longer touched the earth. He felt himself turning end over end, tumbling and falling, but nothing hurt. He felt free. It was as if he had fallen out of his body. The following day, Badger's friends gathered anxiously outside Badger's door. They were worried because he hadn't come out to say good morning as he always did. Fox broke the sad news that Badger was dead and read Badger's note to them. It said simply, "Gone down the long tunnel. Bye-bye, Badger." All the animals had loved Badger, and everyone was very sad. Mole especially felt lost, alone, and desperately unhappy. In bed that night, Mole could think only of Badger. Tears rolled down his velvety nose, soaking the blankets he clung to for comfort. Outside, it began to snow. Winter had begun. The snow covered the countryside, but it didn't conceal the sadness that Badger's friends felt. Badger had always been there when anyone needed him. Badger had told them not to be unhappy, but it was hard not to be. As spring drew near, the animals often visited each other and talked about the days when Badger was alive. Mole was good at using scissors, and he told about the time Badger had taught him how to cut out a chain of moles from a piece of folded paper. Paper moles had littered the ground that day. Mole remembered the joy he'd felt when he had finally succeeded in making a complete chain of moles with all the paws joined. Frog was an excellent skater. He recalled how Badger had helped him take his first slippery steps on the ice. Badger had gently guided him across the ice until he had gained enough confidence to glide out on his own. Fox remembered how, when he was a young cub, he could never knot his tie properly until Badger showed him how. Fox could now tie every knot ever invented, and some he'd made up himself. And of course, his own tie was always perfectly knotted. Each of the animals had a special memory of Badger, something he had taught them that they could now do extremely well. He had given them each something to treasure, a parting gift that would become all the more special each time it was passed on to others. As the last of the snow melted, so did the animals' sadness. Whenever Badger's name was mentioned, someone remembered another story that made them all smile. One warm spring day, as Mole was walking on the hillside where he'd last seen Badger, he wanted to thank his friend for his parting gift. "Thank you, Badger," he said softly, believing that Badger would hear him. And somehow, Badger did.
So having asked you, who was it who inspired you to follow the Christian way, inspired you in the walk of Christian faith? Let me ask you this, what did you receive from those people? What particular insights and gift did you receive? What was it that really caught your imagination? What was it that helped you really understand what faith is? One thing's for sure, whatever it was, whether it was scripture or music or actions or fellowship or architecture or a sense of spirituality, whether it was morality or ethics, whether it was community, whatever it was, that which you received, you had to receive by being hospitable, as the Gospels show us. This Gospel passage for today comes at the end of a whole series of teaching from Jesus about mission, and the theme right the way through it is hospitality. That the apostles and those who are appointed after the apostles to work with them are meant to go and see where hospitality is offered them and the one who sent them. So they go two by two into villages, and if the village receives them, they stay there. And if the villager rejects them, they shake the dust off their feet and go somewhere else. When they find a home that will receive them, they stay there. And if there is no home for them, then they go somewhere else. In other words, the gospel is offered, it's not imposed. You have received the gospel, you received the spiritual gift from whoever it was who inspired you, who taught you, who drew you in, who showed you a different way. And there was hospitality in your heart and mind for what it was they had to give you. And that attitude of being open, welcoming, is what we're looking for. It's what God's looking for, and it's what we're looking for in these days. It's what I'm looking for as I pray and seek the building up of the church community at St. Mary and St. Eanswythe. It's what I'm looking for in the community in which our church community is situated, in the wider community. Who is it? Who are the people of peace upon whom, if I pray God's peace, the peace will rest? Who are interested? I see a flicker in people's eyes. I see interest on their faces, or I see nothing but dullness or boredom. And it's the ones who open up to the possibilities of the gospel, they're the ones who are beginning to show a flicker of that hospitality that we're looking for. And I wonder, therefore, if I could ask you this: having received the gifts that you've received from the people who inspired you to receive them, what is it that you have to give others in terms of the gospel? In what way could you inspire others? And who is it in your life and amongst the people that you know who shows an interest in what you have to offer? Who are the ones who are hospitable to the faith that you have to share in the way that you and only you can share it? I don't mean evangelism, that kind of imposing of your views on somebody else. I'm talking about when you are you in the faith that you have and express it in the way that you express it. Who's interested? Who are the ones who show a spark and who are interested? Can you spend time with them? Can you offer them the insight that you have? Who are those people that you can spend time with? And the kind of welcoming that there is not always a becoming an apostle or becoming like the person that you've heard it from. There are various different possibilities and scenarios in the gospel reading. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. A prophet is a person not who foretells God's word, but forth tells God's word. A prophet is the one who proclaims God's word, explains it, and understand, and helps people understand what God's word means for life and living and the times that they're in. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. Again, these are people who show forth what it means to live in God's way, who show what it is to live in the gratitude and the honesty and the loving kindness of the gospel, of the presence of Jesus, who show forth a peaceable life and what it is to live with God. And then whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly, I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. These are people who show that intuition of kindness, who see a need and reach out to meet it in action. However small that need is, all these are ways of communicating the love of Christ to others. The content of the scriptures, what it is to live the rhythm of a spiritual life that can be so attractive. How it is then others who show how it is that we can begin to meet the needs of others, seeing needs and having the loving kindness to be able to meet them. You will have received the gospel from people like this, and you may be one of those kinds of people. And as you reach out to others and offer simply what it is that you have, when it's received, those people will receive a reward and a gift in the very same way that you receive them. It's worth thinking about. Who is it that I have received the gift of faith from or through? What kind of faith did I receive? What kind of person am I now because of it? What gift resonated with me that I now have? And then, who is it that I can pass this on to? Who are the people of peace? The people who will welcome and give hospitality to the things that I can share? What is it that I can share with them? In the name of Jesus, amen.
This final piece in our mini-series exploring the work of 20th century British composers is a piece by John Rutter, who by any reckoning must surely count as being one of the most successful and prolific contemporary composers of church music. John Rutter was born after the war and he went to school with John Taverner, and he's written many pieces from communion settings through to carols, carol arrangements. He's editor of the Carols for Choirs series, which is extremely well known. He's written a standalone Requiem. He's written a Gloria. So there's an enormous output there. And this piece is called I Will Sing with the Spirit. It's perhaps not one of his best known pieces, although he wrote it back in 1994 when he was commissioned to write it by the RSCM. The text is taken from 1 Corinthians, which in some ways makes it unusual because Rutter often writes his own words as well as music. Lots of his output, I think, sounds fairly simple, almost easy, but it's often a very different experience for the performer. Lots of his music requires quite careful work and quite careful preparation. You need to know where you're going in the score. You need to look out for the rhythms. The harmony needs to be really solid. And there is often more than one or two key changes to watch out for, often involving at least 5 flats. So you certainly have to have your wits about you. It's a piece which we do have in our choir library, but we unfortunately haven't had time to dust it off just yet. It's also true to say that of all the composers that we do, it's often Rutter's music which moves me personally in a particularly special way. I think the energy is very clear and he writes so very well, and the experience of singing or playing or listening to his music often really gets me right here in a way that very few other composers do. So it's quite special to me. And he's very much respected across the whole musical world, I think. And the cathedral choir have a phrase that they often say, making fun of a butter commercial. And they say, "I can't believe it's not Rutter." So there we go. And it's something that David Flood often says. It's extremely rare that they have an entirely Rutter-free Christmas. He's always there in some form or other. This performance is from BBC Young Chorister of the Year, and it was on this radio programme that in fact I first heard this piece. And this performance we'll hear is a duet arrangement which was made in 2017. So let's enjoy it now. I Will Sing with the Spirit by John Rutter.
Hallelujah. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. We pray for the Church worldwide, for Archbishop Justin, Bishop Rose, and for John, our priest. We pray for the leaders of all countries, that their hearts may be touched by humility, that they may be led by wisdom, and that they may govern fairly, righteously, and with equal concern and justice for all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that you, Lord God, continue to bless our earthly home with your presence in rain and sun, wind and snow, from planting through to harvest, secure in the knowledge that with your blessing, our circle of life will continue abundantly for future generations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the lonely and friendless, the aged and infirm, the sick and the suffering, those afflicted by addiction, and all who need the presence of your healing grace, including Andrew and Alan Birch, Jean Anderson, Anne Jarrett, Sheila Blundell, and Vix. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, that they may know that you are their strength, their healing, and their salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who have died, especially those taken by COVID-19. remembering those whose anniversaries fall this week: Rosemary Ballard, Janet Gibbons, Betty Katanakis, and Brian Kinchin. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for ourselves, that in your loving care we can learn to live life to its fullest, that we can learn to love wastefully, and that we can become all that we can be because of the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, by your Holy Spirit, you have made us one with your saints in heaven and on earth. Grant that in earthly pilgrimage, we may always be supported by this fellowship of love and prayer, and know ourselves to be surrounded by their witness to your power and mercy. We ask this for the sake of Jesus Christ, in whom all our intercessions are acceptable through the Spirit, and who lives and reigns for ever and ever. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to himself in one body by the cross. We worship together in his name, and we receive his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Of the running wave to you, deep peace of the flowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth to you, deep peace of the shining stars to
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Eanswythe, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. O God, whose beauty is beyond our imagining, and whose power we cannot comprehend, show us your glory as far as we can grasp it, and shield us from knowing more than we can bear, until we may look upon you without fear through Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.